It's the dead of winter in Maine. My buddy is out of work and squatting in his grandpa's old house. But tonight is a good night, because it's Pathfinder night. Under the influence of amphetamines, he's built his players a scale model of a subterranean thief slayer, right down to the rickety doors with tiny working hinges. After sneaking, stabbing, and poisoning our way through the plywood labyrinth, we've come to a sunken cathedral where a demonic clergyman has ambushed us in what really feels like a final boss fight. We roll for initiative and look at our sheets covered in cantrips and armor classes and spells and HP counts, ready to conclude our adventure with a contest of thoughtful turn-based tactics. And then I notice the pillar. In the foamboard cathedral, there are two cardboard columns. I ask our half-orc fighter if she reckons she could knock one over. Her strength check passes. The demon cleric's dodge check doesn't. On his notes, Buddy puts a line through the demon's HP count and writes zero. Everybody at the table cheers. Later, I asked Buddy if he had intended for us to bypass the final boss fight with those cleverly placed pillars, and he said, absolutely fucking not. But I loved it. I had been playing video games for my entire life, but I had never felt so rewarded for my creativity, and I'd never felt a video game respond to my actions with such specificity. But that's because I'd never played immersive sims like Thief or Deus Ex. But now, we've all played immersive sims. Thanks, Nintendo. Despite not being advertised as one, because it sounds like some boring PC gamer shit, Tears of the Kingdom is kind of an immersive sim. The game has detailed systems, and manipulating or breaking those systems is the whole point. It is fun as hell. You'll find ways of moving Koroks that make you feel like a depraved genius. Simply put, immersive sims are a style of game designed to make you feel the way I felt when we one-shotted the Demon Pope with a basalt pillar. And that's on purpose. Warren Spector had a hand in creating System Shock, Thief, and Deus Ex, three games that defined the genre. His intent was not to create scripted spectacle, but to give players the tools to create their own. He told Glixel, "I've spent the last 33 years trying to recapture the feeling of when I first played D&D in 1978. Spector's games were philosophically different. They allowed the player to approach problems in intuitive, personalized ways. If it seemed like something should work, it usually would. In Doom, you had to find the red key to pass through the red door. In a Spector game, you could do the same thing, or you could stack some barrels and climb into a vent and bypass the red door. Or you could invest in bionic arms and rip the red door off the hinges. Or you could blackmail the security guy and just have him open it for you.
You want the security login? 500 credits.
I'll make it worth your while.
To the tune of what? 2,000?
Never mind.
That's the sim in immersive sim. Rather than limiting player inputs and manually programming responses to their predicted actions, the simulation just handles it. Here's a clear example. In Call of Duty, we've got a button on the wall. If we shoot it, bump into it, or throw something at it, nothing happens. It's not a real button. The anticipated, intended player action is that they'll walk up to the wall and press the button on the controller that makes them press the button in the game. It's manually coded to work that way and just that way. But in 2017's Prey, a button is a button. So if you've got a Nerf gun and good aim, you can pop it from across the room. In a detailed simulation, small things start to matter. Guards are listening for your footsteps, so you should make sure that you walk on the carpet instead of the tile. A faulty power strip will send a deadly current through a puddle. A cliff face will get slippery when it starts to rain. Immersive sims are defined by this overlapping network of systems, which is sometimes called systemic gameplay. AI, physics, the rules of nature. The rules of nature and the player's actions are all dependent on one another. As you spend more time in a given simulation, you'll start to understand its rules. Zelda's Bokoblin AI system compels them to go to sleep at night. Its weather system can produce storms and lightning. Its physics system means that metal objects attract electricity. So what happens if you sneak through that Bokoblin camp at night during a storm, dropping metal weapons and shields by their sleeping bodies? By understanding the rules of the simulation, you can exploit the simulation. Breath of the Wild was Zelda's first massive step towards an immersive sim style, and it gave you lots of tools for manipulating its systems. Ice columns could be summoned from water, metal crates can be moved around, and also you have bombs. And it was really fun. But like I said, these tools were designed to let you manipulate the world, and most MSims don't stop there. Most of the games in this genre will give you tools that in small or big ways allow you to violate the laws of that finely tuned simulated world. In Prey, you might find yourself trying to get into a security booth. There's a little porthole, but you're way too big to fit through it. Unless, maybe, you have the ability to disguise yourself as any object you can touch. Then, just maybe, you could become a little cup and roll right through. Enemies looking for you? Not if you're invisible. Important item just out of reach? Not if you've got telekinesis. And stuff gets even more imaginative when you start combining simulation-bending superpowers. In Dishonored, you can stop time, but still move around freely. You can also possess and control enemies. So that means you can wait for somebody to take a shot at you, pause time, take control of them, and walk their body into the path of their own projectile. The perfect crime. Likewise, Tears of the Kingdom hands players a set of simulation-breaking tools, and they are very fun. Ultra Hand lets you manipulate any non-living object that's not nailed down, regardless of mass. Recall lets you send a moving object backwards through time. Ascend lets you shoot upwards through any solid structure and emerge on the top. These powers are all useful on their own, but together they allow for some genuinely amazing stuff. Let's say you're trying to cross a gap and you need a little height, but there's nothing tall to climb and jump off. But you can use Ultra Hand to suspend a crate in the air for a few seconds and then let it fall. Then cast Recall and watch it float back up into the sky. And as it hovers there, ascend through the bottom. Bada bing. And honestly, this is a boring example compared to what some of these freaks are getting up to. Mechanics like this are really amazing, but they can't just be plugged into any old game. Like a good dungeon master, the best immersive sims want to encourage creativity. So they'll give you open-ended goals and trust you to use your abilities to figure it out. One of the early objectives in Red Dead Redemption 2 is stop this train. But what they really mean is stop this train by planting charges on these exact spots and set up the plunger, but the plunger is going to fail, so run and jump onto the top of the train and engage in a thrilling shootout through the cabins and have a thrilling brawl with the conductor, and if that doesn't work, you fail. In an immersive sim, the objective would simply be stop this train. No small print. It doesn't need to be complicated. Go here, kill this guy, get this thing and deliver it over there. On paper, in another kind of game, these are fetch quests. But simple additions to the simulation create complexity and challenge. The place you need to go is surrounded by a tall fence. The guy you want to kill is in a crowded room full of witnesses. The thing you want weighs too much to carry on your own. These challenges create opportunities for amazing victories and hilarious failures. Making room for these experiences also means eschewing a few decades worth of level design best practices. Game devs have mastered the art of guiding us through our adventures with funnels, lights, landmarks, and clever suggestions. And even in those games that have hidden paths and shortcuts and diversions, there's a certain sense you get when you're approaching what I call a desirable dead end. You're creeping through a dungeon and the tunnel splits. You know that one path will take you forward, and the other will be a quick diversion that ends in a little treat. A chest with a nice little potion or a special sword, and then it's just a quick jaunt back to the critical path. But in an immersive sim, that second path keeps going. It winds around and around, and somehow you come out at the beginning of the level. Or maybe right above your objective. And maybe that diversion path splits into two more paths, and those split, and those split, and those split. It's such a fundamental shift in level design that it can be kind of anxiety-inducing. You might worry that you're going the wrong way, or that you're missing some delectable bit of content. Enjoying these games necessitates unlearning some of your completionist gamer instincts. That can be hard, and I think it's part of the reason why, historically, immersive sims have been a bit of a niche genre. But then a game like Tears of the Kingdom comes along that exemplifies, and in a lot of cases advances, the core tenets of the immersive sim. Hyrule is a massive sim sandbox with weather and wildlife and climates. Monsters patrol and sleep and eat and use the environment against you. The objectives are simple and broad, and you can achieve them by your own means. There have been a lot of Zelda games, and while each one has its own unique thing, they're all perfect little puzzle box worlds. Generally, there's only one way to complete a given quest. You run around the overworld and you see places that you can't get to yet. Then you delve into cleverly designed dungeons in a specific order. You find a new tool that helps you find the solution to the puzzle. Emphasis on the solution. In almost every case, there's one right way to solve the puzzle. One right item to use, one right place to stand, one right switch to flip. When you're done, you exit the dungeon with your new tool, and you might be able to reach some of those places you couldn't reach before. Bit by bit, tool by tool, the world unfolds, and that is incredibly satisfying. But in the two newest games, you're given all of the tools in the opening hours. You're not gated by your gear, just your understanding of the world, its rules, and your tools for manipulating them. Personally, I love it. The old structure did allow the designers to speak directly to the player. In every dungeon and puzzle and battle, you could feel their intent and their vision. And that was really nice. But the shift to a simulation-based approach hasn't turned those designers into absentee gods. Even though the world is big and unpredictable, nothing about it is imprecise. The designer's vision is still there, in the tools they've handed you, in the intricacies of the AI and the world's overlapping systems. And this time, they're listening too. They are the patient dungeon master, saying, "Yeah, sure, you can drive a meat robot into that bokoblin camp. Okay, you can skip that puzzle with a rocket jump. Sure, yeah, you can build that. It's not what we expected, but we love it."